What up, y'all? This is Ed Love, and it's time for Come On, Son, the podcast brought to you by CigarsInternational.com and locally here by Nissan, south of Morrow, 6889 Jonesboro Road in South Morrow. Listen, y'all, I had a great time. Cigar Week here 2017 was absolutely amazing, man. Just absolutely amazing. There's so many cigar places here in Atlanta we go out and have a good time at. Big shout out to everybody that's opening new ones, like my man, opening a Conrad that's got one on the south side here of Atlanta called Cigarros, and he's opening up another one near the airport. King Cigars is near the airport. Oh, my God. Cigar City Club. All of these different cigar places are so freaking dope, right? So you got to understand, when it's going down, it's going down. Let me tell y'all something. You never know what happens when I'm doing a podcast. Say hi to everybody.
Hey.
That's my girl, Jasmine Guy. Just came by to say what's
just
up.
Just came to say hi.
Hey, now,
before, I had so much fun here.
I know that, but before I get into this, because I'm getting ready to interview 112, can I ask you a really quick question? You can just throw a little tidbit, because I've been hearing these rumors of another different world on Netflix.
Like a new one?
Yes.
Oh. Well, I haven't heard it.
So you haven't heard it?
Maybe I'm not in it.
Yeah, all right. All right, Jasmine,
they didn't call me yet.
Did nobody say nothing to you about it yet?
No, I mean, those rumors have been flying for so long, and then we're ready.
Uh-huh.
Like, all the cast. We would love to get back together. I think we'd have a ball.
How do you think that would play out? I mean, where do you think they would pick it up at?
I think that we would, you know, be where we are 20 years later.
Married.
And the kids would, and you know, whatever kids we have would be going to, you know, like a... another fictitious HBCU.
I would love to see that.
So we could repeat that theme.
Right.
But also show what's happened 20 years later.
Right.
You know, where Ron Johnson is,
right.
Where Dwayne and Whitley are.
They're married.
I think they are maybe having marital problems by now and suffering from a little empty nesting.
Okay, so the
kids. That's
kid,
how I think
so
they would
kid,
be.
So with Whitley, I would see Whitley and I would have a girl.
Yeah.
And she's off to college.
Okay.
To historically black college and university. And y'all are suffering from that emptiness because y'all really don't know what to do with each other because your whole focus has been being married and then having that child.
And I think, well, I had them having a son, but that's interesting that you
okay.
had them having a girl. But a one-child thing where
yes.
she poured her life into raising that boy, of
right.
course. He goes off. He doesn't want to go to Hillman. He wants to go to Morehouse. And she's having a kind of existential crisis because she realizes, what have I done? Where is the Whitley I used to be? I knew myself as a wife. I knew myself as a mother, but I want to be my old sparkly self again, you
right.
know, which causes Dwayne, who's always still providing, doing the right thing. It causes them to have to reevaluate their situation, which I think a lot of people at my age, and I have been married for a long time, have to do. You have to reevaluate. It doesn't mean you break up. But the thing about Dwayne and Whitley is that they were always apart and getting back together, always apart.
Right.
And that pulling of that taffy kept the tension going.
Right.
So I feel like we got to pull them apart and get them back together, watch them fight to stay together. And I think Kimberly Reese would be a doctor.
Absolutely,
I
yes.
I think Cree, Frank, Freddie would be a civil rights attorney.
Absolutely.
And I think Ron Johnson would own his father's a string of car dealerships in
absolutely.
Detroit.
Yes.
And follow in his father's footsteps.
Can somebody but please?
That's just me.
That's what I'm saying.
Know?
A different world.
A different world.
A different world would be so amazing. Anybody please? If you're listening, somebody pitch this.
Tom Warner, Marcy Carsey.
Marcy Carsey, they own it. Let's get this thing popping. Y'all see, you never know. Okay, we love you. Jasmine Guy just stopping by, man, to hang out with us for a little while. Y'all heard her idea. It's no way in hell you going to tell me with Amazon, with Netflix, with everything going on, with all these streaming services, nobody could get Marcy Carsey to pick up and redo A Different World and call it A Different World. Come on, son. I'm so glad Jasmine stopped by. Now, off to today's interview. I had an opportunity to sit down with a group, man, that started off. It's not a lot of times that you hear about a group that started in high school. In high school. And when y'all hear about how they started, what they've been through, and where they are, you understand why 112 is a very special R&B group, not just because of how well each of them sing individually, but how great their shows are, the choreography. They're four-man, so they put you in the mind state of the Temptations. They put you in the mind state of New Edition. They put you in the mind state of every great, not only vocal, but entertaining group that we have ever had in the history of all music, and especially R&B music. And they got a new album coming out, a new project, and we're going to talk about that too. And it's been a long time since anybody has had all four of them together, Slim, Mike, Q, and Duran. But they're here. They're with me. Let's talk to them. 112. Come on, son. It's the podcast. Joining me in the studio right now, a bunch of dudes that I've known for quite a long time.
Yes.
Grammy
yes,
winning R&B supergroup 112.
What's up?
And I got all of them, too. I got one of them. I got Mike, I got Slim, I got Duran, and Q.
How about this?
Same damn time. What's up, gentlemen? How y'all doing, man? Brand new project out, too, right? Tell me about the brand new project, man.
Like we said earlier, it's been 12 years since we put out an official project. We've been touring for a long time. Stay on the road, as you saw us on the Bad Boy tour, but now we back, the fans demanded it, and plus, we was just vibing out on the road, so we gave y'all some of our heart on this one. It's
12
it's in
years
right now.
Since your last album?
Yes, sir.
You know the number one question is why?
Why has it
been 12 years?
Well, we want to make sure everything was right.
You took 12 years to do that?
Hey, man. Sometimes, you know what I mean? Look how fast this music changed, you know what I'm saying?
So right.
You listen to the radio, you see where it's going. I mean, we were like, man, how does 112 fit in this? So, you know what I mean? We've been on the road for like 5 years around the world, just doing shows or whatever.
Right.
And we were listening to the radio. We said, man, how we fit in this? And then it took that long, but for us, it was faster than that. And then, you know, we said, okay, we found our niche, got in the studio, bada boom, bada bang.
Right.
There it is, 3 months. Yeah.
3 months? It took y'all to do this entire album in 3 months? So what do you think is your niche right now? Where does 112 fit into this landscape of music?
Well, from what we've been hearing, you know, and this ain't, you know, us being, you know, hubris or nothing like that, man. But, you know, we've been hearing, man, like you guys are saving R&B. It's what we've been hearing.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know about that, all that, man. But what I do know is that our niche is what it's always been. It's just good output, quality music out with substance, and just make sure that we in the clubs and we making people fall in love again, man. That's always been our goal.
Right.
Yeah, so, you know, that's what we doing, man. Like, I can't
really. Simple.
It's simple, man.
As a group, man, it's so tough to be in a group. It's so tough to deal with four different personalities, four mm-hmm. different schedules. I mean, you mm-hmm. guys grew up together. Mm-hmm. You had, you know, you went through a lot of stuff together. Y'all homies, y'all went to high school together.
Right.
You know each other's kids and families and schedules change. How do you balance all of that and remain tight the way you guys have remained tight?
I think, like, with us, when you look at the business, a lot of groups came out, you know, they were put together, you know what I'm saying, and they was auditioned and it was different things of that nature. But with us, like, we actually grew up together. We all went to the same high schools. You know, some of us went to elementary school together. Like, we actually practiced at my grandmother's house. So it's really just deeper than music and deeper than, like, figuring out schedules for us. Like, we actually friends and we actually family. Like, when I lost my sister, I got a call from all these boys. They was there for me. Like, it's not just business across the board. And I think that's what makes it different for 112. It's not just business. We're actually intertwined in people's lives, and it's kind of more so like a marriage.
Yeah, because I know that. I've been married to Dr. Dre for almost 30 years.
You better understand it.
You know what I mean?
It's almost impossible
to go a day without answering a question about somebody, right? Do y'all have that too? Like, go a day without somebody asking you about the other one?
I'll tell you something funny, man. Like, we can't go anywhere and it'd be three of us. Like, say three of us take a picture. Where the other guy at? Where Q at? Yeah. Where Duran at?
Well,
where
you better not take a picture without the rest of them.
Man, for 112, it's always been. It's either all four of it ain't nothing, man. Like,
right.
That's how it's always been, bro.
From 112. Mike from 112. Q from 112. You just can't get away from it.
Yeah. But you gotta embrace it. That's absolutely a beautiful thing. You know, my claim to fame is being in 112. I don't know what your claim to fame is. Yeah. But my claim to fame is being 1/4 of one of the biggest groups in the world. So
yeah. Who gets the credit for starting 112?
What, the group itself?
The group from day one when y'all was Forte.
Okay.
Don't think I don't know that, right?
I like it.
I thought I know y'all was Forte, right? Who started Forte? Who started that? Whose idea was it?
It was Mike.
Yeah, he had to say Mike. Yeah.
How did you okay, Mike, were you in a chorus? Were you singing? What were you doing?
What happened was I met Deron. Here's the thing, man. Like, Deron went to the same summer camp that I went to church at Dodd Sterling United Methodist Church.
Right.
And they had a summer camp. And Deron came up there one day and dude just jumped on the church piano doing da 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 da, and I was fascinated by that. I was like, because I had never met anybody that musically did the same thing I was doing. Like, I understood him, you know what I mean? Like, and nobody else could understand when I was talking music and stuff. Like, they never understood where I was coming from. But this dude understood all that stuff. So when I was singing to him, he was just following along and stuff. Like, keep in mind, this dude, this is coming off of just the dome. This ain't no...
Okay, now how old are y'all at this time?
We're like 10.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, we're like 10 years
old.
So
where did you... Were you playing piano, Mike?
I wasn't playing the piano. I was just in the church. But I've always been able to sing. Since I was like 3, I've always had this big booming voice. And
right.
I was always I was going to say. I don't mean to interrupt you. I'm going to let you finish. But when I met him, this guy was sounding like a grown man.
Okay, and he was like Johnny Gill when he was 13, right?
And this is before puberty hits too, man. So you know, I'm just like this grown man. Right, voice ain't even got deep and sexy yet, man. You know what I mean? But he and I, we grew up. His house was down the street from my grandmother, so we was like in proximity to each other. So I used to go down this dude's house every day, and then we would just talk music and just, you know, he'd be playing something and come with something new. You know, we would listen to some gospel and he would just learn that and we just sing it. And we went to middle school together, and that's when we started, you know, creating the whole, you know, Forte started to develop.
Okay, so you met Deron. Deron, where did your musical ability come from? Is it natural? Did you take lessons? Where did it come from?
Well, it was natural. I was 3 years old. My grandmother had a piano on the porch, and my grandma would always say, you know, when you was 3 years old and all the other kids was outside playing and doing their thing, you know, you was always at the piano, you know, trying to figure out music. So I started playing the piano by ear when I was 3, and then, you know, by the time I was in the second grade, I was playing the piano by ear. I was playing this the cello, I was playing the trumpet, and I was in the chorus at school, the citywide chorus too. So, you know, by the time I was in like the third grade, people always was telling me like, okay, you're a musical genius. So it started with my family. My family is very musical. My mother can sing, my grandmother can sing, my grandfather played the guitar, my uncle played the keyboard. So I really just came from a musical family.
Right. Okay, so now you guys are in middle school.
We're in middle school.
Where you get these two characters from?
Now,
where you get Slim and Q from? All right, Slim, jump in.
We actually had to go to high school.
Okay, see, well, it kind of go before that. Right. Well, my sister went to the same middle school as them.
Okay.
And she would come home and say, hey, I was in chorus, and it's these two guys that's singing the chorus. They sound like you. So I was like, no, no, no. That can't really sound like me. You know what I mean? I know, because all my life, you know, everybody told me my voice was different. You know what I mean? I was never in chorus. I was never in a chorus. I was more academically inclined. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I played the cello and stuff. I was in the Atlanta Youth Symphony, and Symphony Orchestra and stuff like that.
Okay.
You know what I mean? But as far as, you know, unless I was in the choir in church, they wouldn't allow me to be in chorus because my voice was different. They told me you can sing, but your voice is piercing. So my sister told me, hey, it's these two guys, they sound just like you, like they do the same runs as you. I was like, for real? So one time I was at church, and we had this thing where, you know, the churches, you know, say I went to Antioch East Baptist Church. And churches from around the neighborhood would come to our church, and we would go to their church. So there was one time, it was this church called Israel Baptist Church that visited our church.
Okay.
And it was this young man that was probably about 12 at the time. 12, he had a big box. He had a big box. He had his shirt tied, put tie all the way up here, and his tie was real tight. But I'm going to tell you right now. Now, when I seen it, like, they started first.
Okay.
And all of a sudden, this man starts singing, and the man sounded like Stevie Wonder. Now, I'm looking back, and my sister was like,
That's him. That's the guy. Point at him.
So I'm looking back. I was like, man, oh hell no, man. This man ain't about to just come up here and show out in front of me in my church. You know what I'm
right.
Man, hey man, we singing John P. Key. So at the time, so I did my thing or whatever. So at towards the end of the joint, this is how I remember him. I walked up to him and I looked up at him, and he was like, "Hey man, you can sing, man." I was like, "You ain't bad yourself."
Wow.
Then all of a sudden, I come back. It's high school, so I run into Mike. I'm like, "Where in the world? Spanish? No, it was something."
No, we was in the lunchroom.
We was in the lunchroom, yeah, and I said, "So they had this other light skinned guy in the group. You know what I'm saying? He had colored eyes. You know what I'm saying?" So I meet Mike in there, and this is the other guy in there. He's singing. You know
the light skinned guy with
light skin.
Yeah, we ain't gonna give him life like that. We ain't gonna give him life.
Well, you know what I'm saying? I'm listening to him. I'm like, yeah, he can sing. Hey man, I don't know you, man. I can sing better than him.
That's what you told him?
No, you told me.
Now, mind you, I'm a nerd in this school. Okay?
You know what I'm saying?
These guys were popular. Okay.
Okay.
This I'm about to tie Q in here real quick.
All right.
So where I sat, and they'll tell you, you know what I'm saying. So I'm nerds, you know what I'm saying. They sit by themselves, or we got our own little crew.
He sat in the geek section.
I sat in the geek side. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Them, they were very, very popular. So I was like, it took a lot of nuts, cojones, to go over there where he was. I said, man, he said, you know how to sing? Outside, out here in the courtroom. You know what I'm saying? Hey.
We went out there.
Give me about 3 minutes. Man, so I go out there. So I was like, hey, man, y'all know this song? Yeah, come on. So I just started singing. So that was this certain jock. He had on a football jersey. You know what I'm saying? Because it was like, you know, pride, like school pride.
Right.
Built the same way he is now. You know what I'm saying? All American, you know what I'm saying? Football, you know what I mean? Football.
On a roll.
On a roll, you know what I'm saying? He just everything.
Colonel
girls,
Cup.
Love, waves, you know what I'm saying? Wear polo every, you know what I'm saying? That's what, like a rich kid kind of dress.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
He was flying high school.
But this man, dude, fly. Man, he looking at me. So he looking at me like, what? He comes right to my jaw. I promise you. Right before I'm about to start singing. He's like, man, is he trying to sing? Ah! Oh, no, he's already my dad. He can't sing. Oh, time when God. We start singing, he is.
Secretly, he wanted to be part of it.
I saw him in his eyes. In his eyes. So I'm singing. I'm looking right at him.
Right.
So that was the first time the whole school knew that Slim can sing.
Can sing.
Right.
And everybody was like, it went from.
So who are you singing with? You singing with Mike and.
I'm singing
and,
with
Mike and Deron.
And
yeah, this is Forte. This is the origin
Forte.
Of Forte.
Oh, wow.
So it was crazy, right? Because it's
and
almost
Q
like
was
a
laughing
movie.
At you. Is that what you're trying to
say? Clown. Q over there clowning this man,
he's
bro.
He's clowning me. Like, until I started singing.
But did y'all know that Q could sing?
We did not know at the time. We did not at that time. Well, see, Deron and Q.
Q, grab the microphone. Tell me the story, brother.
So while all of that was happening, I knew Deron since fifth grade.
Okay.
Because we were in a citywide chorus together.
Okay.
So by the time I moved to the neighborhood where they all lived, it was middle school.
Okay.
So from middle school, I just sang in the chorus, but they were in show choir. So they would get to sing, like, the popular songs while we just sang all the classical, operatic type
right.
songs. So from middle school all the way to my 10th year in high school, 10th grade year in high school, I had to watch them like become popular as singers. Now, although I was popular because I played sports, I was very studious and academic and stuff, but my passion has always been music. Mm-hmm. So no matter what I played, football, basketball, I was known on the team as the singer. Like I'm like the preacher
right.
of any team. I'm on the football field singing and the basketball court singing. So every day I would see them garnering all this acclaim in the school because they sing. And I really did want to be a part. And but at the time, it was five members of the group. And we sat next to each other in chorus class. Slim wasn't in chorus, but we sat next to each other in chorus class. And I think I tried the group for like two times initially. And I wasn't really, really like serious because I was still trying to juggle practice and
star,
all that stuff.
The superstar.
So I joined the group. They kicked me out like two times.
But Mike, I think, what you kick him out for?
Yeah, because he wasn't coming to practice.
He wasn't coming to practice.
I was just trying to juggle.
That's exactly how
I was juggling so stuff, man.
I pulled him to the side. I was like, hey, bro, what you going to do, man? Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, either you going to do this or you going to, you know what I'm saying, be in this group? Because we serious about it right now.
But I think around my senior year when it got really, really serious and we all just really, like, put our feet in the sand and started performing as this group in the city around talent shows and stuff and started to get a reputation and then...
So there was originally five dudes. There's the light-skinned dude you was talking about.
It was three of them and two other guys.
And two other guys.
What happened to the two other guys? You kicked them out too, Mike?
Listen, they kicked themselves out, bro. they kicked themselves out.
Mike wasn't playing, was he, Slim?
I don't play, man. No, when it comes to this, man, I don't play. But, no, the guys, they were older than we were.
Okay.
You know, and they were, you know, they came to, you know, the oldie wop, you know, hey, man, I got to get a job. I got to do this. And all this other, we were still in, y'all still in high school. Y'all still got time. I got to go get a job. I got to go do this. And we was like, bro, this is serious business, man. Like, we're making moves. I guess it wasn't fast enough for the dudes. So they went to the military. And by when they came back from, doing their tour or whatever, like, we were 112 at that point.
Wow. Wow.
Times Square. We
killing
we came
themselves.
Back. Yeah, we was on Times Square.
Oh my God. Puff. Killing themselves. Other dudes go out, they get jobs. I've been through the same thing. I know what you're talking about. Yeah. And they not in the group, and then they come back and y'all are doing the video in Times Square.
Whoop, 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 whoop.
with Big
Heavy whoop, whoop.
And 112. Tell me about the first time y'all met Big. Tell me about that time.
First time we met Big, man, dude actually threatened our lives. Because it was like four of us, and we were messing with Puff. You know, we was like, yeah, man, we're going, you know, because we from the South, we like wrestling. We like playing around, whatever. So we was playing with Puff. And then we went around the corner, and Big was around the corner. So he was like, yo, y'all look inwards. Y'all better go sit down somewhere. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's just what he was. But he was playing around with us, though. You know what I'm saying? But the first time we met him, he was just like, yo, y'all better sit down with all that. You know what I'm saying? I'm Big Papa. I'm daddy here. You know what I mean? So that was the first time we actually met him. But, like, dude was just, he was just such a funny dude, man. This one time, like, our manager at the time, he was like, yo, Big is in the kitchen. Like, at daddy's house. I know you've been to daddy's house.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know how small that kitchen is, right? Uh-huh. So dude is in there, right? So it's only assembly line that you can, you know, you're going to do it one at a time. So Q go in first, Deron goes in first. By the time he get to Slim, he's like, yo, it's 112 of y'all for real, B. You know, stop. Yeah. That's just how he was, you know. Yeah. He was just like that kind of dude, man. But anytime that Big saw us, man, he always showed love. Like, he was one of our biggest fans, if not the biggest fan on Bad Boy as far as advocating for 112 to do things. Puff would be like, nah, I don't want him to do that. Big is like, nah, man, you got to let them boys sing. You got to let them boys sing. And that's the reason why we were so intertwined in a lot
of
records.
Did y'all go to Bad Boy with the name Forte? Who took y'all to Bad Boy?
Yeah, Kevin Wells initially brought us to Bad Boy, and at the time we did have the name Forte, you know what I'm saying? But 112 was kind of like a nickname for us around Bad Boy because we had sang for Puffy in the parking lot of 112. So,
oh, really?
Yeah, so that's kind of where the discovery initially started. We sang in the parking lot for Puffy outside of Club 112. And then from there, people just kind of
started. How did that happen? Did y'all stalk it out? Like, were y'all somebody call you and tell you Puffy was in the club, or were y'all in the club and so on?
Kevin was good friends with Puffy at the time.
Okay.
So he knew that he was there, and so he had us positioned, waiting.
Yeah, because we weren't old enough to get in. We had the who ride.
Oh, y'all way too young to get 112, right?
Yeah, 16, yeah.
That's how it started.
Yeah, we had the who ride on him. It was like, there go Puff. Yo, skirt. Hey, man, we got a sing. He was like, yo, I ain't sing. And so the line from 112 went from being a line to, like, you know, circling us. Yeah, and then so he knew then, it was like,
what
okay.
did y'all sing for him? Do you
what
remember?
Didn't we sing? Yeah, man, we sang Boys to Men. We sang
whatever we knew.
We sang It's So Hard to Say Goodbye to Yesterday. Silk. We sang Lose Control, Silk. We sang Jodeci. We sang everything,
Take
bro.
Six.
Take Six.
Good God. And Puff stood there, let y'all sing that many songs?
Oh, yeah, he tormented us, bro. Yeah. Like, he was like, keep singing.
He was like, you know, I think at this point, it don't matter what y'all saying. It's just going to sound good.
I think he couldn't believe it was real. Like, one thing about, you know, music and when you're discovering a talent, like, it's content. Like, it's like finding somebody with 50 songs already or five albums. You can't believe this. Okay, let me hear something else. I don't believe it. Let me hear something else. I don't believe it. Okay, these guys can sing all night. They got, like, 50 songs in their repertoire. Like, and I think that really compelled him to say, like, okay, these boys for real. They serious.
What did he say? He said y'all were good and walked away, or he told Kevin bring him to, you know, let's
he
make
was
something
like,
happen.
He really kind of gave us the nod, like, yeah, y'all dope. But then like 2 weeks later, he came back to Doppler Studios, and we did like another official audition for him with Faith Evans and Usher at the time, because he was EPing Usher's first album. And once we sang for him that time, Faith looked at him and was like, yo, if you don't sign these boys, you crazy.
You crazy.
So she kind of helped stamp us. And that, you know, that's why our relationship with Faith is just so.
Oh, wow.
Oh, my God. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. And then he changed the name to 112. Yeah.
No, we actually had to change the name because of Rapping Forte.
Really? From the Bay Area?
Yeah, from the Bay Area. Because he was popping group at the time. They were like, we didn't want to, you know, confuse anybody with Rapping Forte here. So, yeah. And then just out of respect, he was an OG. So, you know what I mean? Like, yeah, so we're going to give him, you know, his
like
just
Biggie
due.
Had to change his name from Biggie Smalls to Notorious B.I.G.
Right.
Some little white rapper was called Biggie Smalls.
Right.
Dumb. Everybody called him Biggie Smalls anyway. It didn't matter.
It didn't matter anyways.
What were your thoughts? Were you in the studio when Big put his verse on Only You the Remix, or did you hear it after it was done?
After.
I think we heard it after the fact.
We weren't there.
What did you think the first time you heard it?
I mean, we loved it, man, because at the time, you know, Big was like hot. He was popping.
Did you bug out? Did you be like, wow, we about to kill him with this?
Notice too.
we really didn't like fall in love with hip hop initially. You know, we were just four guys who just wanted to sing. Give us a piano, some girls in front of us, and we just gonna sing all night. Puff introduced us to the hip-hop genre.
Okay.
So that's why 112 is now known as hip-hop and R&B, because the two worlds just collided. So when we hear Big, I know I wasn't a rap fan at the time. You know, Deron and probably Slim was, but a lot of us just grew up in church, so we couldn't really listen to that music anyway.
Oh, wow.
So when Big comes on there, we know who he is because he's popular. And the fact that he rhymes on our first single, it really, like, introduces us to the world. So it's like, if Big gets on our record, now everybody that's a fan of Big now becomes a fan of 112, because he basically says, these are my little brothers. Mm-hmm. I'm going to stamp them. I'm going to get on their record.
And him and Mace.
Yeah, and it became in Times Square.
You know, Mace was coming off of, 3 million selling album or something like that?
Well, nah,
we introduced Mace.
Yeah, that's right. Mace hadn't dropped it.
Yeah,
that's right. Wow, so that was huge.
Yeah, man.
That was very big.
Shutting down Times Square.
At the end of it all, what do you want people to remember most about 112?
That we were, in our minds, the baddest that ever did it. As far as, I'm talking about the best, bro. You know, that's the legacy that we're striving for, you know, and with respect to everybody else that did it before us. And it wouldn't be a 112 if it wasn't for them. But if you don't go out and try to be the best at what it is that you're doing, then ain't no sense in playing this game.
Bro, I'll tell you one thing. Y'all dudes is tight as hell on stage, man. Your harmonies are always on point. Your vocals are on point. And your choreography is I don't even understand how y'all still doing it. Watching y'all, I'd be out of breath.
What's so funny? Like, when you saw us last time and you was like, yeah, I saw y'all on the Bad Boy tour, and you commended us about the performance, I was like, yo, that meant a lot, because you done seen everything. You done seen everybody, and you ain't going to hold no punches
but
either. You going to
tell
you the real.
Because when people, I'll tell you this one thing about 112, and I mean this from the bottom of my heart. When you pay money to see 112, you're going to get a show from 112. You're going to get your money's worth. You're not just going to get a half-ass, well, we're just coming out here, we're going to do these couple of songs, and then we out. They're going to give you a show each and every time out. And I think that's why you guys have had longevity. And I think that's why now you'll all be in your 60s somewhere still performing.
Wow,
and that's a testament to being a great vocal group, as well as a great group with great choreography and dance moves. If you ever watch the history of R&B, you know the people that give that kind of show are the people that last the longest.
Absolutely.
My mama still go to see the Temptations. There's only one of them still alive. You know what I mean? And she will go see them. The Temptations review.
Yeah, right. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's that legacy that you're going to get kind of show out of somebody every single time.
That's
man.
Right.
Brand new album. We were students of it. So we literally sat down and watched the Temptations. We watched the Four Tops. We watched
New
Edition.
Yep.
Right. The Men. So if that was who inspired us, we had to continue the legacy, man, and continue the movement. So it's so funny that whenever any other members from New Edition or Boys and Men see us, they always commend us on the stage presence. You know, we're never going to be that group who just going to show up and, as you said, just, you know, walk across the stage and do a couple of songs. It's always been about the performance, and it always will.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, that's great, man, because we did Soul Train a while back. Everybody will be able to see it November 26th, but the funny thing is, like, you know Brooke Payne, right?
Yeah, of course.
Man, Brooke Payne was sitting right in front of us before we got on stage. He turned around and looked at us and said, I'm going to be watching y'all. Like, you know, because we're
Brooke
student.
Brooke is the one that taught New Edition.
And he taught 112 as well.
Yeah.
So, you know, and big shout out to him and Leon as well, man. But he turned around and looked at us and said, bro, I'm going to be watching y'all. To this day, that's still scary, bro.
Wow.
To that day. Yeah. Them thumbs better be in, dog.
I'm saying,
them thumbs better be in, dog. They got to be.
Keep it clean,
bro. Wow.
Brooke
is a monster. Name of the new album?
Q Mike Slim to Run.
Yes.
You can get it. It's out right now.
It's out right now. Please go out and get that thing,
man. Absolutely.
In stores and online.
Q Slim, Mike, and Deron, thank y'all so much, man.
Hey, man, thanks.
Always a pleasure, man. Always a pleasure. 112 in the building.
This Ed Lover podcast is being done in conjunction with Cigars International. Make sure you check out CigarsInternational.com for all your cigar needs.
This episode of Come On, Son, the podcast, is produced and engineered by co-executive producers Kimana Paulus and Krista Hayes. Recorded at Mean Street Studios in downtown Atlanta, Georgia, this is an official Loudspeakers Network podcast.